terrorism has evolved from the London bombings 10 years ago. With more on all of this, we're joined by David Gartenstein Ross, rather. He's senior fellow at the Foundation for Defense of Democracies. Why don't we talk about the differences 10 years ago, today? What are the major differences you see?
I think the major one is for these groups is opportunity. 10 years ago, if you look throughout the region, Middle East and North Africa, most of the regimes were thought of as being, you know, you're in charge, it's a lifetime position. You know, they hadn't been able to topple any governments, and it seemed like a remote possibility. 10 years ago, there were only debatably two safe havens for terrorist groups, that being Iraq and Afghanistan. Somalia was in the process of becoming one. Today, it's a very different picture. Today, there's a large number of ungoverned spaces that these groups can exploit where they can try to push out any form of recognized governance. There are a lot of fragile regimes in the region, and they have a lot of opportunities in the Middle East, North Africa, and sub-Saharan Africa that they did not have 10 years ago. As such, a lot of the danger has shifted from Western countries into that region, but obviously Western countries are very skittish as well, and you do see attacks in Europe, for example.
One of the things, I think 10 years ago, it seemed like Al-Qaeda wanted dramatic one-offs, if you will. It would have been rare for me to be on the air 10 years ago and do an entire block talking about Al-Shabaab, Boko Haram. I mean, the whole landscape has changed, and I think it's directly what you're talking about. The landscape on the ground has changed, too.
Precisely, because these groups aren't really, at this point, terrorist organizations. Obviously, they do use terrorism, but primarily we can think of them as insurgent groups. Terrorism and insurgency are basically points along the same spectrum. A terrorist organization generally uses terrorist attacks, that is, attacks against civilians, in order to try to provoke a government overreaction, in order to rally the population behind them. An insurgent group, in contrast, already has reached that point where it can pose a military threat to the government. So we're looking at a broad range of insurgent organizations, and in ISIL's case, it's really a quasi-state organization. It performs a lot of the same services that a state does. It has governance set up. So that they've evolved dramatically over the course of 10 years in terms of their sophistication. And obviously, terrorism also is something that is done as they expand outwards. We saw the awful attack in Sousse in Tunisia, the attack the same day in Kuwait. These are all theaters in which you don't have an insurgent group on the ground, and they're announcing themselves through, really, terrorism.
And Sousse, you brought that up, 30 Brits killed on that day. I mean, it's the second worst since what happened 10 years ago. Let's talk about homegrown terrorism, because I think back then it was shocking to people that these were homegrown terrorists. And yet, the last stat I looked at, 700 Brits have traveled to Syria and Iraq to work with ISIL. Talk to me about how that has changed over 10 years.
Yeah, you've had over 4,000 West Europeans go over to Syria and Iraq to fight with jihadist groups over there. This is another significant change. 10 years ago, when we thought about the word social media, something that had not entered the vocabulary, if you used those words, you'd be thinking of blogs. You'd be thinking of you know, a much older generation of internet technologies. And now you have, you know, Twitter, Facebook, these mediums that provide a feeling of intimacy with someone who's half a world away. You don't just read the blog of someone who's in Syria, but rather, if you're interested in jihadism, up until recently, when Twitter became much more vigilant about pulling down jihadist Twitter accounts, you could, you know, immerse yourself in a jihadist milieu, talking to people who were in Syria, in Iraq, on the front lines, and that's changed radicalization patterns. Not just for people going over to Iraq and Syria, where you already have more people who've gone over to that theater than went over to Afghanistan during the entirety of the Afghan-Soviet war, but also in terms of the possibility of what we call lone wolf terrorism, that is, single actors who carry out acts of terrorism like what we saw in France on the same day that we saw the attacks in Kuwait and Tunisia. You've seen this massive spike in lone wolf terrorism compared to previous years. It's very easy to see it statistically. And I think part of the reason you're seeing that is because terrorism used to be a group thing. And now social media is really taking the role of that group, a group that will reinforce someone's extreme ideas, spur them onto action, and not allow them to back out.
You talked about this changing pattern, so obviously there has to be a change in tactics. How do you combat against this?
It's complex. I mean, in terms of online radicalization, that's an area where I think there's a lot more potential. For one thing, Twitter is getting much more vigilant about pulling profiles down. Same thing with Facebook. If you can get these guys off of major platforms, that really reduces their ability to radicalize people. It used to be that someone could, you know, just easily chat with someone who's an ISIS member, whereas now the cost has gone up because of the way Twitter pulls profiles down. As to the strategy for the region, it's tough because if you look at Libya, Syria, Iraq, these are festering sores. Tunisia is going to have a lot of trouble solving its own terrorism problem because Libya is right on its border. Mm-hmm.
David, always a pleasure having you on the broadcast. Thanks so much for stopping by.
My pleasure.